जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम हरे राम राम हरे कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्ण हरे 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 राम हरे राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्ण हरे 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 राम हरे राम 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 हरे
Ram 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 कृष्ण हरे 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 राम हरे राम 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 हरे हरे
हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे
हरे कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्णा हरे हरे
ओ रंग
हरे राम 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 हरे हरे
हरे कृष्णा
हरि बोल
कृष्ण कृष्ण हरे 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 राम हरे राम 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 हरे हरे
हरे कृष्णा कृष्णा कृष्ण हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे
जय प्रभु पदा
प्रभु पदा प्रभु पदा जय प्रभु पदा
जय जय प्रभु पा प्रभु पा प्रभु पा प्रभु पा
जय जय प्रभु पा प्रभु पा प्रभु पा प्रभु पा तो पावन हरिनाम संकीर्तन की
जय। हरे कृष्ण
जय राधा माधवा कुंज बिहारी जय राधा
कुंज बिहारी
जय राधा माधवा कुंज बिहारी
जय राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी
गोपीजना वल्लभा गिरिवर धारी
गोपीजना वल्लभा गिरिवर धारी
आनंदना ब्रजदन रंजन
यशोदानंदन व्रज जन रंजन
यशोदानंदन व्रज जन रंजन
यशोदानंदन व्रज जन रंजन
यमुना तीरावन चारी
यमुना तीरावन चारी यमुना तीरावन चारी
जय राधा माधव
कुंज बिहारी
गोपी जना
गोपी जन वल्लभा गिरिवर धारी
यशोदानंदन व्रज जन रंजन
यशोदानंदन व्रज जन रंजन
यमुना तीर
ಮಾನಚಾರಿ ಜಯ ರಾಧಾ ಮಾಧವ ಕುಂಜ ವಿಹಾರಿ
ಹರೆ ಕೃಷ್ಣ 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 ಹರೆ 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 ರಾಮ ಹರೆ ರಾಮ 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 ಹರೆ ಹರೆ
ಹರೆ ಕೃಷ್ಣ 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 ಹರೆ 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 ರಾಮ ಹರೆ ರಾಮ 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 ಹರೆ ಹರೆ
ಹರೆ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಹರೆ ಕೃಷ್ಣ 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 ಹರೆ 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 ರಾಮ ಹರೆ ರಾಮ 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 ಹರೆ ಹರೆ
ಹರೆ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಹರೆ ಕೃಷ್ಣ 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 ಹರೆ 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 ರಾಮ ಹರೆ ರಾಮ 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 ಹರೆ ಹರೆ
ಹರೆ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಹರೆ ಕೃಷ್ಣ 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 ಹರೆ 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 ರಾಮ ಹರೆ ರಾಮ 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 ಹರೆ ಹರೆ
ಹರೆ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಹರೆ ಕೃಷ್ಣ 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 ಹರೆ 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 ರಾಮ ಹರೆ ರಾಮ 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 ಹರೆ ಹರೆ
ಹರೆ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಹರೆ ಕೃಷ್ಣ 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 ಹರೆ 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 ರಾಮ ಹರೆ ರಾಮ 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 ಹರೆ
ಹರೆ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಹರೆ ಕೃಷ್ಣ 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 ಹರೆ 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 ರಾಮ ಹರೆ ರಾಮ 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 ಹರೆ ಹರೆ
ಹರೆ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಹರೆ ಕೃಷ್ಣ 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 ಹರೆ 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 ರಾಮ ಹರೆ ರಾಮ 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 ಹರೆ ಹರೆ
ಹರೆ ಕೃಷ್ಣ 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 ಹರೆ ಹರೆ
ಹರಿನಾಮ ಸಂಕೀರ್ತನಕ್ಕೆ ಅನಂತ ಕೋಟಿ ವೈಷ್ಣವ ವೃಂದಕ್ಕೆ ಶ್ರೀಲ ಪ್ರಭುಪಾದಕ್ಕೆ ಓಂ ಅಜ್ಞಾನ ತಿಮಿರಂಧಸ್ಯ ಜ್ಞಾನಾಂಜನ ಶಲಾಕಯ ಚಕ್ಷುಃ ಉನ್ಮೀಲಿತಂ ಯೇನ ತಸ್ಮೈ ಶ್ರೀ ಗುರವೇ ನಮಃ. ಶ್ರೀ ಚೈತನ್ಯ ಮನೋಭೀಷ್ಟಂ ಸ್ಥಾಪಿತಂ ಯೇನ ಭೂತಲೇ ಸ್ವಯಂ ರೂಪಃ ಕದಾ ಮಹ್ಯಂ ದದಾತಿ ಸ್ವಪದಾಂತಿಕಂ. ವಂದೇಹಂ ಶ್ರೀ ಗುರೋಃ ಶ್ರೀಯುತಪದಕಮಲಂ ಶ್ರೀಗುರೂನ್ ವೈಷ್ಣವಾಂಶ್ಚ ಶ್ರೀರೂಪಂ ಸಾಗ್ರಜಾತಂ ಸಹಗಣ ರಘುನಾಥಾನ್ವಿತಂ ತಂ ಸಜೀವಂ ಸಾದ್ವೈತಂ ಸಾವಧೂತಂ ಪರಿಜನ ಸಹಿತಂ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಚೈತನ್ಯದೇವಂ ಶ್ರೀರಾಧಾ ಕೃಷ್ಣಪಾದಾನ್ ಸಹಗಣಲಲಿತಾ ಶ್ರೀ ವಿಶಾಖಾನ್ವಿತಾಂಶ್ಚ. ನಮಃ ಓಂ ವಿಷ್ಣುಪಾದಾಯ ಕೃಷ್ಣಪೃಷ್ಠಾಯ ಭೂತಲೇ ಶ್ರೀಮತೇ ಭಕ್ತಿವೇದಾಂತ ಸ್ವಾಮಿನಿತಿ ನಾಮಿನೇ ನಮಸ್ತೆ ಸಾರಸ್ವತೇ ದೇವೇ ಗೌರವಾಣಿ ಪ್ರಚಾರಿಣೇ ನಿರ್ವಿಶೇಷ ಶೂನ್ಯವಾದಿ ಪಾಶ್ಚಾತ್ಯ ದೇಶಧಾರಿಣೇ ವಾಂಛಾಕಲ್ಪತರುಭ್ಯಶ್ಚ ಕೃಪಾಸಿಂಧುಭ್ಯ ಏವ ಚ ಪತಿತಾನಾಂ ಪಾವನೇಭ್ಯೋ ವೈಷ್ಣವೇಭ್ಯೋ ನಮೋ ನಮಃ. जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे। जय श्री श्री राधा कुंज बिहारी की, श्री श्री गौर निताय की, श्रील प्रभुपाद की जय। सो वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू फॉर एवरी वेडनेसडे अवर गीता फॉर ऑल मेड इज ए गेम कोर्स पीटी कोर्स पॉजिटिव थिंकर कोर्स। टुडे वी आर going to discuss on a topic called the four regulative principles of freedom. I have made two doc files and one PPT for you. I will share part of it with you, whatever time permits, and then we will leave the balance material for you to refer to yourself on your own. So we will recite one shloka from Srimad Bhagavatam. It's a very important verse. So this verse talks about, just a minute. Yeah, I'll see this one. There are two verses. Maybe we will recite this one first and then we'll go to the other one. 1:17:24.
Tapashaucham daya satyamiti vada krite krtaha adharmam shair strayo bhagnaha smayasanga madaistava.
Translation.
In the age of satya, truthfulness, your four legs were established by the four principles of austerity, cleanliness, mercy and the truthfulness. But it's appeared that three of your legs are broken due to the rampant irreligions in the form of pride, lust for the woman and intoxication.
Yeah. So this is actually, the talk is between a cow and a bull. The cow representing the earth and the bull representing dharma. So dharma has four legs about which I have discussed in another session with all of you before. Match formula, mercy, austerity, truthfulness, cleanliness. And the last H is holy name. So I will not be elaborating on this because already we devoted our time for this. But opposite of this four we will be discussing today. Austerity is spoiled by intoxication. Austerity means what? Voluntarily accepting some restraint for ultimate good. That is austerity actually. But intoxication means, you know, ruthlessly, you know, greedily taking things without any restraint. Just the opposite. And cleanliness, opposite of that is illicit sex. When one indulges in illicit sex, when man and woman, when they come together, they do dirty things. So then that is illicit relationships. And the opposite of mercy is meat eating. It's a merciless act of slaughtering animals. And opposite of truthfulness is gambling, which involves lying, cheating and all that. So here in this purport, there is one very important statement I will show you. Here Prabhupada says, see, read this one.
Such a strong man of character were competent enough to get away from the clutches of Maya.
Yeah. So if we all become strong men and women of character, that means we have to follow these four things. Match formula, you can remember. Mercy, austerity, truthfulness, cleanliness. And also avoid the other four which I told you. That you can remember, a gimme formula. Gambling, intoxication, meat eating and illicit sex. So you avoid a gimme and do the match formula. So if you follow these four and avoid those four, in this way, then we become people of very strong character. And then we can get away from the clutches of Maya. Maya cannot, Maya's grip on us will become very slack. She can't catch very strongly if we strictly follow this. Read further, but gradually.
But gradually, as basic principle of Brahmanical culture, namely austerity, cleanliness, mercy and truthfulness, become the curtain.
Became curtailed by proportionate development of pride, attachment for women, and intoxication, the path of salvation or the path of transcendental bliss retreated far, far away from human society. He says that when we don't follow these four principles, that means austerity, cleanliness, mercy and truthfulness, then the result is what? Pride, madai, sangas, smaya madai, smaya sangais, madaistava, it says. So smaya means pride, sangha means attachment to the opposite sex, and mother means intoxication. So about that, Prabhupada says here below. If you see here, so Prabhupada says here, with the progression of the age of Kali, people are becoming very proud, very much attached to women, and increasingly victimized by intoxication. Three things he's saying: smaya, sangair, madaistava. Smaya means pride, sangha means attachment to women, and smaya, sangair, mada means intoxication. Now what are the people of Kali Yuga proud of? Prabhupada saying even a pauper is proud of his money, he is saying. People are educated in schools and colleges for material science. They have no knowledge of who am I, where am I going. There are many children even in very top premier institutes committing suicide, not knowing who they are, and they are getting academic pressures. But they are still proud that we are highly educated. They are practically ignoramus in spiritual knowledge and the values of life, meaning of life and all. And similarly, everybody is attracted to the opposite sex. Women are also, Prabhupada says, dressing in an overly attractive fashion to victimize the minds of men. Women are exposing their bodies, improperly dressing, and they are also coming out and moving amongst the people in society, just like in the West. So now because of this, kind of man-woman interaction increasing and women not properly dressed, is saying that the illicit connections are increasing, and that is actually polluting the whole world. Thirdly, he is saying they are also intoxicated. How? By wine, by smoking, drinking tea, chewing tobacco. So these are all symptoms of Kali Yuga. And if we indulge in any of these symptoms, then we also will become victim of Kali Yuga. If we want to keep ourselves away from the effects of Kali, we have to avoid these three things. Smaya, Sangair, Madaistava. He is saying. These are all called the advancement of civilization. But Prabhupada says this is the root cause of all irreligiosity. He is saying it's the root cause of all irreligiosities. It's all irreligion. Such a kind of lifestyle. He says. So, I'll show you another verse. So, that verse talks about the four sinful activities. We'll recite this verse. Abhyarthidas tadatasmai sthanani kalaye dadau dyutam panam sriyasuna yatra dharmaschaturvidah. Yeah. So, Suta Goswami said, Maharaj Parikshit, thus being petitioned by the personality of Kali, gave him permission to reside in four places where people are gambling, drinking, prostitution and animal slaughter. These four things, wherever it goes on, there Kali resides. I heard a story. Once upon a time, a Brahmin wanted to meet a king. But the king was living in a huge palace, and the palace was having four big doors on four directions, north, east, west and south. So the Brahmana went from the south gate, but he was stopped by the watchman there. They said, here is a building here, you have to go there to register. After that only we can allow you. If they permit, we will allow you. So when he went to the gate, yeah, he went to the small building, he asked them. So there was a fellow with liquor bottles. He said, see, you have to drink here. Only if you are drinking liquor with me, then only you will be allowed to go and meet the king. Then the Brahmana said, I am a Brahman, I don't drink, how can I drink? Then we cannot allow you, he said. Okay, he thought I'll go by another gate. So he went to another gate. There he saw there was similar type of entrance and another building. There was a prostitute there. She said, you have to associate with me. Only then you will be allowed to go in. So he thought, such a dirty woman, if I associate with her, I will get diseases. So a low-class woman, and I am a Brahmana, I am not supposed to fall from my position. So he said, no. And then he left and went to the third gate. So there in the third gate, in the similar building was there by the side of the gate. They told him that you have to sit here and eat with us. But then he asked, what I have to eat? They said, you have to eat meat. We will supply you goat and chicken and everything. Only then we will allow you inside the gate. He said, I am Brahman, I am vegetarian. I only eat food, prasad, I don't eat all these things. They said, no, then we can't allow you. So then he left that gate and went to the fourth one. He thought, at least in the fourth one I should be allowed entry. But there was again another building there by the side. There they called him and told him, see, if you want to go in, you have to gamble. Now the Brahmana thought, oh, at least out of the four, this is the most mildest. I don't mind gambling for a few minutes. And then once they allow me, I can go and meet the king. And king will give me abundant wealth. So with that idea, he agreed to gamble. So when he started playing gambling, he won. He made a big money. So then when he again played, he made even more bigger money. Now he got a very big sum. So he thought, I wanted to meet the king. But even before meeting the king, I made a good money here. Now if I meet the king, he will even give me more. But before meeting the king, he said, let me first, you know, utilize this money that I have hard earned with this gambling. For last 2-3 hours I have been playing. So he thought, let me go to the other gate. So there they told me that I can eat meat. So let me eat meat now, because I have so much money now. So his mind became, buddhi became brashta. So he went to that gate where they were giving meat. He started eating meat. And then he told one of the men, hey, go to the other gate and bring me liquor also. Because the meat goes along with liquor and onion and everything together. So he started biting onion, eating meat and drinking liquor, all of them, and he ate a very heavy meal. And then after he ate a very heavy meal, he felt a lot of stamina, strength. Now he wanted to enjoy. And he thought, oh, there was one prostitute who was inviting me. I didn't go that time. Let's go there. So he went to that gate. And then went and indulged with her. So in this way he became completely polluted. Although he was a Brahmana, he became extremely degraded by breaking all the four. These four are mentioned here, no? Gambling, drinking, prostitution, animal slaughter. All the four he did. Dyutam, Panam, Sriya, Suna. Now he told all of them, see, I have fulfilled all of you guys' criteria. Now allow me to go and meet the king. They told him, are you a fool? We were actually testing you. Those people who succumb to these four things, they will never be allowed to go and meet the king. King is a pure devotee. I mean, you won't be able to meet him. He's a great personality. Get lost. They actually, because he was drunken fully, and they looted his money and they bet him severely and drove him out from that place. So he was a failure when he ran away from there. So from this story, what we learn, that king who is living in the big palace in the center, who is he? He is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And there are four regs. If those people who don't break these four regs, when they go to all the four gates, the fourth gate, when they are not breaking all the four, then they will be allowed inside. But this fellow was not aware. He foolishly succumbed to the fourth one, the gambling. And from gambling he got money. When money came, he indulged in all other bad practices. And he completely got ruined in his life. So all of us are born in this world. When we come, if you tell about these four things, the students and working people. We should not gamble, we should not drink, we should not have illicit sex, and we should not do animal slaughter. Many people don't have a serious reason to avoid these things. Many people think, what's wrong in indulging in these things? Who has seen what is beyond after death? Just when you are getting these things, just enjoy. So people are living like cats and dogs, with absolutely no awareness of where are they coming from, where are they going, what is the meaning of life, what is the goal of life. Therefore, those who have taken to Krishna consciousness are very, very fortunate, because we are trained in these things systematically based on the scriptures. See, here is a great secret revealed. If you avoid these four things, you are avoiding sinful life in one stroke. These four are called as the four pillars of the building of a religion, on which the building of religion is standing. Sometimes you all might have seen a housing colony is standing on many pillars, and below they have a garage kind of, they have a car parking lot, correct, no? And many pillars are there on which the whole building is standing. If those pillars are broken, the whole building will collapse. Similarly, this whole building of sinful life is standing on the four pillars of Dyotam, Panam, Striya, Sona, meat eating, gambling, intoxication, illicit sex. So you break these four, pillars, sinful pillars, no more sinful life. After that, you can put a full stop to sin. So therefore, we are going to discuss about this today. So in this way, these are explained in the Srimad Bhagavatam also. First I will show you the article and then we will go to the PPT. It is written by one Rohini Nandan Prabhu in Back to Godhead. He calls it as a four enemies of spiritual life, he is saying. Is it big enough? Coming properly, yeah. So, these are the four enemies of spiritual life, because they become stumbling blocks in our advancement in Krishna consciousness. So, you can read the yellow one, whatever is written yellow.
In the body, there is an eternal unchanging soul who has a fully blissful relationship with the Supreme Soul, Lord Krishna or God, that he has now forgotten. Because of this forgetfulness, we all undergo the inconveniences and miseries of material life, like old age, disease, apparent death, and many others. And we lead lives that fail to give us enduring happiness or full satisfaction.
Okay, you understand, huh? This is the very first point made, that we become forgetful of who we are. Actually, we are not just body. Body is just like a dress over the soul. Krishna says that. Like every day you all change your dress. Now, yesterday you had one dress, today you have another dress. Similarly, the Atma changes bodies, one life to next life. But this is completely forgotten. People, when you were a small baby, you thought, I am a baby. When you became a young man or a young woman, you thought, I am a young man or woman. When one gets old, one thinks, I am old. Actually, one is neither young nor old. One is actually a soul different from the body. Body is only a car inside which we are sitting. And that is forgotten. So the gurus are coming in parampara and they are teaching us. The Vedas say that any society based on these principles of spiritual realization, that will naturally make you peaceful and prosperous. For example, when you say that I am leading a Vedic life, Aryan, you say you are Aryan. Aryan means there are certain codes of conduct explained. For example, one has to treat every woman as a mother, except one's own wife. That's the kind of dealing one should do with women. And one should see all the living beings as children of God. One should not envy them, one should not attack them, one should not harm them. And one should not loot others' property. Because every property is put under someone's custody, one cannot encroach on others' property. Similarly, one should align with the Vedic literature, and the nature is mother and God is the father. So one has to align with mother and father, which means nature and God. So in this way, there are many things taught in the Vedic literature, and some of them also teach, some of the teachings teach that one should accept one's quota and be satisfied, and one should not loot and accumulate a lot. Nowadays you find very rich people accumulate crores and crores of rupees, while the poverty-stricken people are starving, not getting any food once in 3 days also. So according to the Vedic literature, you will see that the animals and birds, they are never greedy. You put a sack of rice, bird will come, little eat little bit and go away. Dog will come, eat little bit and go away. But a man will take the whole sack because he is greedy by nature. So one has to give up this kind of greed, one has to give up envy, one has to give up competitive mentality with other living beings. And in this way, when one becomes God-centered, his life becomes very simple. If you follow these four principles, but people are not following, so therefore they engage in degraded activities. So, now what are the degraded activities they engage in? This is what I told you just now. When this I already told you. Yeah. So one by one we will go here. First gambling here, yeah. Yeah, read it, all the yellow ones.
Gambling is taken to mean not only betting with money.
Betting with money.
Betting with money over games or sporting events, but also speculative, dishonest or illicit business dealings. The primary
now what happens in this? For example, you bet with money over games or sports. Big money people keep for betting. And then sometimes they lose, sometimes they win. It causes a lot of mental tension. And also when you do dishonest business dealing or cheating business dealing, you can't be peaceful. Because the person who got cheated is not going to keep quiet. He will threaten you over phone. He will threaten that I'll beat you up or I'll kill you. So can one live a peaceful life after cheating another person? So that is actually gambling. Gambling means big money or no money. Imagine somebody looted your $10,000 in gambling. So you develop a vengeance for him. Hey, this fellow looted my money. Maybe I'll beat him up and take back my money. Then you resort to violence. Cheating, violence, you know, murder and all those things come. Yeah. And the other results like loss of mental equilibrium, suffering of the participants when there is a loss, you get depression, you get hopelessness. You think I had saved so much money, all my money went in gambling, you see. And then in one becomes very dishonest and then one resorts to cheating. Yeah. So therefore, one cannot live a peaceful life by such gambling. And the same thing when it extends to the field of religion, then one may also speculate about God and bluff anything about God. There are many cheaters even in the field of religion. They are just trying to make money or become popular or write many speculative books with no reference to Shastra. So the same cheating propensity can come there. So I will show you PPT parallelly, so that for each of it we will see. So these are four relative principles. What is this one? Meditating. What is this one? Drinking. Intoxication, drinking, smoking, tobacco and all that. This is illicit sex. This is gambling. So these six formidable enemies that bind us in this world, lust, pride, greed, anger, illusion, and all these things. Lust, pride, and envy is not here. And instead of envy, greed is there. So you will find that these are the things. These become aggravated when we break these four principles. See, all the living beings in this world are like puppets in the hand of three gunas. Sattva-guna, Raja-guna and Tama-guna. So, but we have to actually, by devotion service, you can go beyond these three pull and push mechanism of Maya Devi. If you chant Hare Krishna and follow the four regulative principles strictly, that's why Prabhupada said, when you become men and women of character, then you will not be made into puppets like this by three gunas. And we can go to the spiritual realm where there is eternal happiness, eternal nitya lila, we call it, going on eternally. But if we don't return there, then we are born again and again. Like you see the material world, the perverted reflection is a world of so much rat race. Everybody running every day, all day. You know, this world is a, as it is mentioned. See here, there are three desires in this world. One is desire to create or do something revolutionary, new. Strong desire, attachment to result, that is passion. And then the desire to maintain, that involves sattva, sattva guna, self-control, patience, sense of duty and all that. And there is a desire to destroy. It arises from ignorance, foolishness, carelessness, inattentiveness, sleep and irresponsibility. So, why am I talking about the three gunas? Out of the three, the sattva is the best. By adopting a lifestyle of sattva guna, we can become tameable. We can tame our mind. Like you see, the cows are tameable animals, and elephant is also a tameable animal, and they can do a lot of good work. Cows can give milk, they can give gobar, they can give cow urine medicine, and even after the cow dies, the skin is used for so many purposes. Similarly, the elephant, it can lift logs of wood, it can tear down the trees, it can give ashirvad, it can be a temple elephant, so many things it can do. So, we want to cultivate this sattva guna, where we can tame our mind and be very productive in spiritual life. And then we can actually systematically follow the spiritual life in sattva guna. Here is where steadiness is possible. Otherwise, the passion, these are aggressive animals. They cannot be tamed and walked on a road. They are aggressive creatures. They are always in a mood of attacking and killing. Similarly, there are people who are aggressive, especially people who drink, who smoke, who have illicit connections. They all come in this category. And similarly, the animals in ignorance are lethargic, lazy, like the, they keep awake whole night. This fox is a nocturnal animal. Similarly, people who drink and smoke, they go to bars, permit rooms, they spend whole night keeping awake, watching cabaret dances and things like that. So such people are compared to the foxes. Their life is very dirty. They drink, smoke and everything. If we see the times of the day, the early morning, is compared to is sattva guna, and the middle of the day is in passion, and the night is in tama guna. Similarly, early morning you see this devotee is sitting and chanting peacefully, so you can calm the mind very easily in the early morning. You can focus with concentration, and daytime everybody is running to office, passion. The night is in a bar or permit room drinking liquor, and look at his behavior. He is going mad, he is going wild. So in this way, so the three times of the day, spiritual life means early morning hours are very conducive for all of you, you are all devotees. So therefore, rising early in the morning is very valuable. So adopt sattva guna behavior and rise early in the morning. And the material conditioning makes us bound, especially rajaguna and tamaguna. They put us behind the bars like this. And we suffer because of this. What suffering I will show you now in the future slides. But in sattva, you can become like a free bird. If you go to sattva and beyond sattva, you feel carefree. Freedom is given more and more as we come to sattva. See here, when we are in spiritual world, we are love of God. But that love turns into lust, like the milk turning into curd. And then from the lust comes anger, illusion, tamaguna and suffering. And it is a downward spiral, you see. On the other hand, if we can convert our lust into love by harnessing into positive energy, then through sattva guna and through four regulative principles if we follow, then again we can get the love and eternal bliss. Choices, whose? Ours. We have the choice. Prabhupada simply says this, three things only you have to keep in mind. All of you repeat, enrich goodness, diminish passion, curb ignorance. Yeah. That means ignorance is laziness and lethargy. Destroy the lethargy. Get up. Don't be lazy. Take initiative. Don't be depressed. Don't be hopeless. Don't get bogged down by worries of the past and fear of the future. Get up. So curb ignorance. And diminish passion. Actually, we need passion in order to do some activity in this world. But the passion can be guided. So if the passion, like Rajas Raja means Raja, the east of Rajaguna also. So, but that was guided by Brahmanas. So our passion can be guided by Gurus and the Prabhupada's books. So therefore, we have to diminish passion. And goodness, what we should do? Enrich goodness. So enrich mode of goodness, chant the holy names of Hare Krishna and follow the four regs, then we can convert lust into love and we can attain eternal bliss. Otherwise, if you don't do that, the downward spiral is here. Pa for Baba, Ma. Says, no? Pa for Parishram. People slog hard in this world. And then fain comes in the mouth. Fain means, foaming in the mouth like donkey you've seen when it carries heavy load. It has fain, the foam in the mouth. And that leads to eventually bondage. People get bound by these four bad habits. They always develop fear. Now, fear arises due to various reasons. When a person has to indulge in these four bad activities, he loots and cheats and many things they do. Therefore, they have to fear anytime they'll be beaten up. And also there is mrityu at the end. So this is the power ga, we call it. Pafa babama. Hard struggle for survival of all living beings in this world. But opposite of this is called apavarga. Apavarga means those who are taking to Krishna consciousness and ascending towards the spiritual world. That is called apavarga. Both words you will find in scripture. Sadam prasangan mama virya samvido bhavanti hritkarna rasayana kata tajoshanadashu apavarga vartmani. It says, apavarga vartmani means they go back to Godhead. Shraddha ratir bhaktir anukramishyati. If you come in the company of devotees, regularly recite Krishna Katha, and then you will ascend to the spiritual sky, apavarga. Otherwise, powerga, he says. Yeah, see the mode of goodness, you get an idea. Just have a look. What is this husband, wife, Mr. Bright family, what are they following? So, you can see their simple lifestyle, they're very happy. They do religion as a duty. The husband and wife are chaste and they're chaste to their partner, chaste to the spouse. And they avoid all these bad activities, meat eating, gambling, intoxication, illicit sex and all that. So they read philosophy books, all the qualities like honesty, truthfulness and everything. And see this family after Dr. Smith and Larry in passion. They are very eager for showing glamour. They sometimes go for parties where they may drink also. They may smoke also. For them money is honey. They want to have a palatial bungalow, and big car. There's a very strong attachment between man and woman. And they disregard the scriptures. They think, just be a gentleman, just be a good lady, just be happy in life, be positive, be motivated in your material work. That's all. They have nothing to do with God. They are in their own world. And the people in ignorance, they are foolish and mad and no interest in spiritual life, lazy, always depressed and dejected. And they indulge in especially intoxicants, drinking, taking tobacco, smoking, taking to drugs. The hippies were like this, and Prabhupada met them. From this stage, he brought them to Sataguna and beyond. Sleeping too much, now then. So now you get an idea by this. See, what happens to people in ignorance? They become birds or bees or reptiles, trees. People in passion, they become, because of their passion to achieve things, they may become a rich man or a madman also sometimes. Or people in goodness, they are elevated to higher planets. But if you practice Krishna consciousness, that is pure goodness, beyond goodness also. Then you return back to God. That's called Vishuddha Sattva, we call it. It's not even Sattva, it is Vishuddha Sattva. So why? Because you only act for Krishna. You don't act independently. Krishna says, follow the four regulative principles, you follow. So chanting Hare Krishna. In this way, chanting Hare Krishna eliminates all of our sinful reactions. Even sinful tendencies go away. all our ignorance is finished and we rise above animalistic propensities. So each of these four I have shown now, for each of them. For example, why no meat eating? Actually, you can take health consideration. I have not written much here, but I can tell you verbally. Actually, if you very carefully observe the human body, scientists have analyzed that the human intestine is 30 feet long. Whereas the animal, like a tiger or lion, their intestine is just 1 or 1.5 feet long. So when the animal eats flesh of a deer or something, it easily digests and throws it out. Whereas in our system, it goes through a long distance, so it undergoes decay. When the flesh undergoes decay, it causes cancer and other diseases for meat eaters. So they are more prone to cancer and such deadly diseases. Doctors say that. Another thing, our gastric juice in human body and the gastric juice in tiger and lion, there's a big difference. They have a 20 times more concentrated gastric juice, like tiger, lion and all. But we have, human gastric juice is very mild in nature. So they have, human body is not fit for digesting meat. It's only fit for digesting herbs, like we say herbivorous, correct, no? So scientists have also proved that actually our human body is more suited for herbivore, not for carnivore. Similarly, I gave you scientific reasons now. Health-wise also, those people who eat the products of violence like meat and all, see, when you're killing a goat, the goat tries to escape from you, but still you catch and cut it, then the result is what? The goat initially tries to escape, then it tries to attack. It's called flight and fight. Initially tries to flee from you, later on tries to show the teeth and attack you back. So both passion and ignorance are there. Flee means which mode? Mode of ignorance. Because mode of ignorance is fear. They try to run away. And showing the teeth and trying to attack us, that's passion. So both ignorance and passion are there when you are killing an animal. So the animal's body secretes adrenaline, which spreads over its body. So when you cut it and eat it, adrenaline goes in. We also become like, you know, insecure creatures in ignorance and also passionate creatures in due to mode of passion. So we don't get sattvaguna by eating meat, we get rajoguna and tamaguna. Economic consideration also, and meat is certainly very costly compared to vegetables. It's a costly affair also. And even Muslims, you know, although Muslims eat a lot of meat, but if you read Quran, it says two words, halal and haram. It says that if you want to eat an animal, you can only cut it on a stone altar in the mosque. You cannot get it cut by somebody and purchase it. There is no question of, you know, somebody arranging a big slaughterhouse and killing thousands of animals. Even in Quran, it is not mentioned. Quran says that if you want to eat meat, your family members, then you go to the mosque, and how the animal should be killed also it's mentioned. You have to cut some certain nerve where they leak out the blood and without pain. And then an animal passes away, then you cut its body into, wash it nicely, and 8 parts you have to cut it. 7 parts you have to give in dan, charity. Only 1 part you are allowed to eat. So you can imagine which person will be eager for buying and eating like that. It's thoroughly discouraged even in Quran. That means, you know, 7/8 of the part you have to give it away. Only 1/8 of the part you are allowed to eat. Basically, you are being discouraged. And if you don't do all this procedure, it's called haram. Haram means sinful food. And for that, they will be taken to hell and punished. So if you have to do halal, you have to spend a lot of money. Haram, you will be sent to hell. So what is the solution? Don't eat. That's all. And slaughtering of animals is prohibited in Mecca, which is a very holy place. And also we become what we eat. Here you see the Sunday feast in ISKCON is completely vegetarian, offered to Krishna, purely cooked and offered devotion. Simple vegetarian food. By eating this, sattvaguna increases. Sattva and vishuddha sattva. Please read it quickly. Prohibited in Bible.
Meat eating prohibited in Bible shows that God does not accept even the prayers of meat eater. Isaiah 1.11.15.
He that killeth an ox.
So you don't have to read the number.
It's as if he slew a man.
Next.
It should be a perpetual stature for your generations throughout all your dwellings that ye eat member of your blood.
Ye eat neither fat nor blood. Very clearly it says one should not eat, okay?
It is good neither to eat flesh, nor to drink wine, nor anything whereby thy brother stumbleth or is affected or is made weak.
Yeah. You know, stumbleth or is offended or is made weak, he's saying. So these are all quotes from Bible. I have more, I think, yeah. Read it.
To what purpose is the multitude of your sacrifices unto me? Said the Lord, I am full of the burnt offerings of rams.
Rams means pigs, pigs. Pigs are called rams, yeah.
And the fat of fat beast. And I delight not in the blood of bullocks or of lambs or of goats. When you spread forth your hands, I will hide mine eyes from you.
Lord says, if you offer these dirty things to me, I will close my eyes and turn my face away from you, he's saying.
Yeah, when ye make many prayers, I will not hear, for your hands are full of blood.
Just see. So you can find this. And if you see the New Testament, there are many quotes also, but what the translators have done, wherever it is said as food or nourishing food, refreshments, so they have made it into meat. Actually, therefore one should go to the Hebrew, Hebrew version of Bible and see the original word and try to find out from the dictionary what is the meaning. You will see that. Yeah, in Vedas, needless to say, read one or two, yeah?
Yes. He who desires to augment his own flesh by eating the flesh of other creatures lives in misery in whatever species he may take his birth.
Yeah, like that there are some more also. Yeah. See, if you desire beauty, faultlessness of limbs, long life, understanding, mental and physical strength and memory, you should abstain from acts of injury, it says. So see? Yeah. Similarly, this is in Quran. Read it.
It is mentioned in the surah Al-Maida that within the limbs of Mecca, most holy place, slaughtering of animals is prohibited. Animals of the chase are forbidden while you are in the sacred precincts or the state or in the state of pilgrimage.
What does that mean? That means the more closer you go to God, even Allah, you know, you are told to abstain from these kind of acts which are very violent and sinful. Here you will see, this is also in Quran, forbidden to you for food or the meat of dead animals, blood and flesh of swine and that on which has been invoked in the name of other than Allah, which means without offering to Allah in the mosque, if anybody is arranging for a big slaughterhouse to cut it and sell it and make money and all that, it's not allowed, it says. And the dead through beating, that which has been killed by strangling or by a violent blow or headlong fall or by being gored to death, which has been partly eaten by wild animal, and unless you are able to slaughter it, that which is sacrificed on stone altar in the mosque, forbidden also is the division of meat by raffling with arrows, that is impiety, he's saying. Can you imagine? How many rules are there in Quran also, you can see that. Yeah. So there are more details are given here. So he says here in the last part, if you see, you can read this, on the day of judgment.
On the day of judgment, all dead creatures will come to life and will take vengeance on those who had either teased them or killed them. This concession is given by Allah to those who cannot restrain from meat eating. By eating halal, lawful meat, they will gradually subdue their passion and give up meat eating.
That is the goal. By eating halal also, gradually they should give up. That's the whole idea.
This will help to develop fine spiritual sentiments, namely love for Allah.
Yeah. Okay, that was about meat eating. And here is about gambling. So, why no gambling? You can see, this fellow is going mad, you see. Because when you get a lot of money, you go mad. When you lose all money, one goes mad again. Yeah, you see, there is the untruthfulness or cheating leads to corruption and quarrel, and gambling. Unlimited restlessness, he says. Yeah. Because people also do beg, borrow or steal. Huh? In order to, because if you have lost the money you had, then you want to borrow some money from somebody and put it in so that you can get all the money back. But then you lose that also, this also. Everything like this. So, therefore you will find, even in the example in Mahabharata, we find when Yudhishthira Maharaj and the Pandavas, people ask, why did they gamble? They're such noble souls. Actually, Yudhishthira Maharaj was not aware at all. He was called by Dhritarashtra to come. Because uncle is calling, they couldn't refuse. Elder is calling, so they came. And the uncle told, my dear Yudhishthira, you and my sons can go to the building. There's a beautiful pleasure bungalow there. You all go and have some games and have fun together. I just called all of you to entertain you. Either he said. So when he went there, Shakuni was there, Duryodhan was there, and then they were saying that we have called you to this building so that we can play gambling match. Mm-hmm. And Yudhishthira Maharaj looked at Shakuni and Duryodhana and said, so are we just like that going to play, or are we going to keep any stake? He asked. So Shakuni said, are we children just like that to play a game? We are all royals. At least we should keep some gold, some silver, some diamonds, some coins. We should begin with that. At least 100 coins you can begin with, he was saying. At that time, Yudhishthira Maharaj folded his palm and cried. He said, uncle, please do not take away the wealth that I have accumulated for serving the Brahmins and Vaishnavas. Actually, I am afraid because the gambling is the root cause of all misery. I would have never come here. I only came because uncle called me. So me and Pandavas, we came. And then he asked, who is going to play, Duryodhana or somebody else? And Shakuni came in the front and said, I will play on behalf of Duryodhana. Ha ha ha. So he was putting the dice. He was very expert in dice. Who? Shakuni. Huh? Whatever number he wanted, he got. So Yudhishthira Maharaj thought that it's order of Dhritarashtra. How can I say no to him? And we will keep a small money and then finish it off as soon as possible. So he began. But the very nature of gambling is what? You gradually get dragged into it, more and more. And then over a period of time, he kept his wealth, he kept his kingdom. Ultimately, he kept his own wife, Draupadi. Even though he and his brothers lost themselves, they were all supposed to go to forest, he kept his wife on stake. Of course, the noble Yudhishthira will never do such a thing. It was certainly Krishna's inspiration from his heart, because Krishna wanted the big Mahabharata war to be fought in the long run. He had a big master plan that Pandava should go to forest, Draupadi should be insulted in the Sabha, and Krishna will give her unlimited sari. So the world will come to know Krishna is Bhaktavatsal Govinda. Krishna wanted all these pastimes to happen. But that is one side of the perspective. But we have to learn another side, that how even noble and noble men of character can become degraded by indulgence and gambling. That's a warning for us. And why no intoxication like drinking or smoking? Yeah, read it.
Why no intoxication? Robs good intelligence, increases perils. It takes one through upward kick.
Perils means sufferings, yeah.
It takes one through upward kick and downward depression.
See, for example, somebody drinks a liquor or smokes a cigarette or eats tobacco, boop, like that it takes up. And then it brings a person down, 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 not to here. It takes the person a little more down. So that is the time he feels little depression. To compensate for the depression, what he does? Again, one more he will take. Then it takes even more higher and takes even more below. So in those days, I heard that Marlboro cigarettes, they used to come to the colleges and give free cigarettes to the students. Anybody can pick up one or two or whatever you want. Free samples. So students smoked it. Because in India, anything you give free, people accept. Correct, no? They were smoking. And then they got used to it for a few weeks. Then the company started saying that now you have to pay the price. And they would put their shop near the college. Boys would come out and purchase one packet, two packets. And this is how they got addicted to it. They just couldn't give it. Now how the boys got addicted, this is the mechanism. When they smoked, they got a kick, relief from tension. But then when they went down, depression, then they would ask for a second one, third one, and then they started drinking four packets, five packets like that. So all these intoxicants have addictive tendency. There are many videos in the net, you will find out. regarding how addictive these are, liquor or smoke or tobacco, all these things. Once you get into it, it's like a bottomless pit, very difficult to come out. So, but people have gone into it and they suffer very terribly. Even when Prabhupada went to San Francisco, at that time Mike and Jan, they were from New York and they had gone to San Francisco. So Mike had one friend called Sam, who was a very great musician, and he was very, very good friendship builder with many people. But the Sam had a girlfriend, Marjorie. So they both had taken to so much drugs that they were almost at the verge of death, practically. And if another 2-3 months they continued eating drugs, they would not have survived also. They were at the verge of collapsing. And at that time, this American Jain came from New York and told them, "We met one Swamiji. He has taught us Mangalarati, Narsingharati, and he taught us this chanting Japam. If you do this, all these bad habits will go away and you can stay high for ever." So they said, "Okay, please teach us something. Nobody is able to make us stop these drugs." So they picked it up. And sure enough, Sam and Marjori completely came out of it. And they became Shyam Sundar Prabhu and Malati Mataji in ISKCON. They became very intimate disciples of Srila Prabhupada. So in this way, Prabhupada did a great miracle in West by making people... So he gave them a higher taste of chanting Hare Krishna. By that higher taste, they could kick away the lower taste. Yeah. Now, why no illicit sex? Like you see in this picture, a man who is doing balatkar, forcibly raping a woman, he becomes a dog in the next life. Similarly, find these kids nowadays, even school-going kids are watching all dirty things in their smartphones. So they prematurely see things which are not good for them to see, and they get very degraded. For example, if a man and woman get married at the age of 20, 25, they are allowed to have sex and beget children, and then raise the children in a responsible way. But imagine if these children are watching such things. These little boys, little girls are watching in their tender age, in their teenage. So they get thoroughly degraded, because they can't responsibly enter into family life at that age. Because they are all... Most of the people think nowadays, at the age of... boys become almost 30 nowadays. Girls are almost 25, 26 to marry. So till before that time, they get degraded completely with multiple changing partners. And because they are indulging in sex after seeing all these dirty things, then the result is they go for abortion. Many boys, girls, free mixing leads to abortion. Read it.
Why no illicit sex? Because of romance, men have been killed, families have been broken, and wars have been fought. Dangers of free mixing, AIDS, complications in...
AIDS is not the only thing. There are more than 25 STDs, sexually transmitted diseases. Yeah.
Glory of brahmacharya and chastity.
Yeah, and the complications in life. What are the complications? For example, a boy coming from one particular religion, caste, he indulges with a girl from another religion, caste. Now, parents don't want them to be married, but in school days, college days, they connect and they are unable to separate. They are attached to each other and the parents are objecting. So very strongly objecting. So sometimes the boy and girl, they run away and get registered marriage done. I know of marriages where the boy and girl belonging to some particular strong natured caste people, they got into married relationship and the family members killed them actually. They finished them. It has happened also. So therefore it's called complications. Similarly, there was an engineering boy. In the first year he started connecting with the girl, in second year end, the girl became pregnant because of their intimately connecting. And the girl's village members came to the college. They came with the... that they cut the fasal, no?
Sickle
they call it. They came in a jeep with sickle and everything. They said, "We'll cut your head if you don't marry her." She was already pregnant. On the day of marriage, she was already pregnant by him. And he never wanted to marry her. He thought she's a loose woman, still he had to marry. All these complications come. And also, illicit sex not only means having sex, I will also show you just one more thing. can see this. There are eight aspects of sex explained by Yajna Vakya. He says, smaranam means one shouldn't even think of opposite sex. Instead, one should think of Krishna and his service always. Absorb our mind in that. Similarly, kirtana means one should not talk of sex life or prajalpa with others loosely, like you saw those boys and girls talking. One should not have such loose kind of talks, but talk about how to advance in Krishna consciousness, practice silence and gravity. Keli, smaranam kirtanam, keli means don't dally with opposite sex. That means don't hang around with the members of the opposite sex in the bus stop, in the train, in the college, hanging around and dallying and joking. It's called flirting or coquettish, we call it. And prekshanam, standing in a busy street, watching who is coming, who is going, looking lustfully. Instead of that, one should go to your ISKCON temple and look at the favorite deity form and awaken love for the Lord. And guhya bhashanam means, you know, talking privately and intimately with member of the opposite sex in a secluded place. So, guhya bhashanam means one too becomes too close to the member of the opposite sex. They go to beach, they go to movie, they go in a car behind and they get close. They may go to the point of embrace and everything with unknown, not even married, they are just in college days. Instead of that, one should actually become a friend of Krishna or consider Krishna as our well-wisher and pray confidentially to him. And sankalpa means deciding to engage in sexual intercourse. Actually, if you go to Google search and you put the word dating, what it says is, one person goes with another person, you know, just to develop a very close rapport and building a new relationship. It can even be, you know, mother and children, father and children also. It's said like that. But generally nowadays, the word is taken to be like a boy and girl going somewhere. And then they clearly say that. If you see the Google, the meaning given there, it says that they come together, but they only develop friendship. It's nothing to do with sex. They say that. But it has been seen that when a boy and girl come in a secluded place, it can go up to the sixth stage of sankalpo, which means they may decide to engage in this kind of behavior. And adhyavasayascha means don't endeavor for sex life. Endeavor for saintly association. Endeavoring for sex life means chasing after the opposite sex. Going here, going there. And kriya navrittir means finally engaging in intercourse, which is the most sinful. Actually, one should know that one has no right to touch the body of another man or woman because the girl belongs to the father before her marriage. After marriage, the girl belongs to her husband. And after that, the son protects the mother's body. So nobody has the right to... Therefore, the Pani Grahanam is said. Pani Grahanam means the father gives the hand of the... Pani means hand. Grahanam means catch. The father is supposed to fix a man, you know, whose hand will be connected with his daughter's hand, and then he goes around the Agni, it's called Agni Valam, several times promising that, oh my dear girl, I will take care of you till your last breath. I'll give you a house, I'll give you clothes to wear, ornaments to wear, and I will protect you, I'll take care of you. And then a man is allowed to have sex and beget children, and not otherwise. But otherwise, all complications in life. And then, I have written one more point, like you can see here. By indulging in illicit sex, these are the things we lose. Like shaucham, cleanliness, and concentration, dhyan, dhriti, determination, naishtiki shanti, everlasting peace we lose. Although temporarily we get some flickering pleasure, we will lose everlasting peace. Vichara shakti, we cannot think only, one goes mad only. And dharana shakti, we cannot hold anything in the mind. Mind becomes very volatile. Viveka shakti means what is right, what is wrong. Inability to discriminate. Like that, all the fine qualities are lost by this. On the other hand, for example, when one comes to the teenage, the hormones start secreting in the body. So one is suddenly shocked, what is this? semen that is produced. Actually, semen is right from the top of the head to tip of the toe. It is an evaporated state always. So if one does not indulge in these 8 things I told you, what Yajnavalkya says, then one remains pure. A boy who remains a brahmachari, he doesn't indulge with opposite sex. You know, what happens to his semen? Semen is not produced in the body at all. The semen remains in an evaporated state in the body, and it gives him tenacity in the body. He's physically, he can be healthy, and mentally he can be emotionally very strong. And he feels security and safety in the feet of God. He doesn't emotionally long to connect with opposite sex at all. And spiritually he becomes very strong. Therefore the Ojas Shakti develops. The semen flows upwards, it is said. It's called Urdhvaretas. Urdhvaretas means the evaporated semen in the body, it flows upwards and nourishes the brain. And the Ojas is produced by which one becomes extremely intelligent. Extremely sharp in memory. And he gets a Viveka Buddhi to make decisions in life. What is right? What is wrong? What to do? What not to do? What is Maya? What is Krishna? Which will give me long-term happiness? Which is short-term happiness? Clearly one can see. Tada tada pashyati vastu sukshmam. It says, because he has restrained the senses, he gets the ability to perceive the subtle things in life which ordinary gross people cannot perceive. So, those girls who are yet to be married, they are called Kumaris. They are also considered very pure. They carry the kalash on their head. 12 girls will carry the kalash on their heads in the beginning of any procession. After that, the brahmanas will chant Vedic mantras. Others will follow behind, you will see. Even they are highly respected. So the girl should be trained to be chaste to the husband whomever they will marry. And the boy should be trained in brahmacharya. And then if a brahmachari wishes to marry after some years of training, then he may marry. Such a combination of girl and boy will produce saintly children. Very powerful children in the home. And this is about the semen. Nicole says that this vital fluid semen carried back and diffused through his system makes him manly, strong, brave and heroic. But if it is wasted, it makes him effeminate, weak and physically debilitated, prone to sexual irritation, all that, disordered function, epilepsy and various diseases, he says. So if one can suspend using generative organs unnecessarily, he can increase bodily and mental and spiritual vigor. He says like that. You can see. Even modern day doctors have understood, found out this now. So, the Vedas are the manual for us, Guru Sadhu Shastra. If you faithfully follow it and give up these 4 sinful activities, this I already told you, enrich mode of goodness, and follow the 4 regs and chant Hare Krishna, then you are free. These other notes, I'll just show you fast. Actually, in ISKCON, we also avoid coffee and tea also. Why? Because coffee contains caffeine, a drug. Tea contains nicotine. But in case any of you feel that you can't give up coffee, it's very difficult, you are from South India, people take filter coffee in South, it's very famous. Then you can take herbal coffee. We have herbal coffee is actually a herb only. It tastes like coffee, but it is healthy also. It doesn't have any caffeine. You will get it in ISKCON temples. Herbal coffee, herbal tea. That's a substitute for tea and coffee which contain drugs. We don't want to take those things which contain drugs. One time, one lady in South, she drank filter coffee two big glasses and she fainted unconscious because of the drug. Too much drug is there in that. So, actually already we are intoxicated thinking I am the body. We don't want to increase our illusion. Illicit sex means any sex outside marriage, or more clearly there should be no sex for any purpose other than begetting children. Actually, Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita that husband, wife, when they come together and beget children for raising in Krishna consciousness, that is religious sex, he says. Otherwise, man-man, woman-woman, nowadays connecting, that is also considered illicit because it doesn't produce any children. Can a man-man come together and do something with each other and produce anything? They can't produce. It is simply to titillate their bodily pressure and that sex is also considered illicit. Similarly, woman also, connecting and doing something, these things are all counted as illicit. Similarly, any sex outside marriage or any sex before marriage. Therefore, this I already told you. I told you with the examples. Actually, what happens, he says here in this article, it's a very important point, read it.
When one engages in sex outside of marriage, or even in marriage when not children, but sexual pleasure is the desired product, the result is that if children come, they are unwanted. We desired only to enjoy sex, the parents lament. But now this child has come and we are being inconvenienced. Or worse than this, the father abandons the mother and child, or the child is rejected by both parents. Such unwanted children are naturally brought up with insufficient affection and guidance, lacking any kind of proper upbringing, and lusty because they were conceived out of lust only. They easily fall into bad association with demonic people and become dangerous, vice-ridden rascals.
They become Varna Sankara type. Varna Sankara means you can see in the streets of Bombay, many children, they are not properly born to proper mother and father. And they become terrorists. Tomorrow they can become thieves, highway robbers, looters, all kinds of. And ultimately the people, public will suffer because of that. Therefore, one should not produce such children. According to Srimad Bhagavatam, a mother and father who cannot deliver their children by Krishna consciousness, you know, then they will also terribly suffer. Guru na sasyat, pajano na sasyat, pita na sasyat, janani na sasyat, daivam na tatsyat, na patisya sasyat, na mochayet, yat samupetam rityam, it says. In the face of death, you know, one should not become a guru, one should not become a devata, one should not become father, one should not become mother, one should not become a husband. In this way, if one cannot take responsibility for the dependents and giving them Krishna consciousness. So parents who produce children like cats and dogs and leave them without attention, they will also get incur sin. Either he says, Also people do contraception, abortion, all these things, complicated things, Therefore one should indulge in sex in only marriage, and especially at times when the children are likely to be conceived, and the husband and wife should be devotees of the Lord, and they should raise and educate the children in Krishna consciousness. Then they are wonderful family. Now, somebody may have a question, you know, within family life, somebody has married properly, husband, wife, so why not enjoy sex for the sake of pleasure? What's wrong in that? Actually, sex life increases bodily consciousness. That's one point he has made. If it is unrestrained, it multiplies material life. It also increases bodily consciousness, dehatma buddhi. It increases. One becomes and degraded in spiritual life by unrestrained. So therefore we say sex for procreation, not for recreation. When one comes to Krishna consciousness, one should gradually come to the highest standards which are mentioned here. By keeping the life pure, you know, then husband and wife, they should have abundant spiritual engagements. Rise early in the morning, have Mangalarti, Narsingarti, Tulsi Arti, chant holy names, read Prabhupada books, take up Bhakti Vriksha programs, preaching engagements. Mataji should train the children and girls and other family ladies in the daytime. And Prabhuji also takes some responsibility in the temple. And they gradually build up a group of 30-40 people whom they care for. And then when so many people they have to care for, then they forget about material sense gratification. That is how one should grow. So you can read this article. I have highlighted some portions for you. There are also many adverse psychological effects also I have mentioned in this. So this article is a very nice article by Roni Nandan Prabhu. So Krishna is giving us all a invitation. Eat food that which is offered to him. Prasad which contains Krishna's mercy. So even vegetarianism is not enough. One has to propose that even monkey is vegetarian, he said. But Prabhupada said, we are Krishnatarian, he said. That means we have to make sure we offer it to Krishna first before we eat. And that will give us higher taste to give up all the lower things. So I will stop here and take some questions because These articles, we will upload it today only. Along with the PPT also, you all can go through. I have two articles and one PPT for you on this topic, so we'll give you, okay? Yeah. I'll save it. Okay, Jyoti Mataji is asking. Second, Kantimala पहनाने के लिए कुछ संस्कार करने पड़ते हैं क्या? मैंने प्याज लहसुन का फाइन 5 महीने से छोड़ दिया है. वेरी गुड. एक्चुअली कंटीमाला पाने के लिए आपको सिर्फ क्या करना है, कंटीमाला मंदिर में जाकर ले लीजिए, भगवान के पुजारी के पास दीजिए, भगवान के श्री चरणों में वो अर्पित करके भगवान को प्रार्थना करके आपको दे देंगे. और वो मिलने के बाद आप तुरंत पहन सकते हैं, नो प्रॉब्लम उसके बाद. लेकिन अगर एक बार पहन लिया आपने तो कांदा लहसुन हमारे गले के नीचे नहीं जाना चाहिए, कांदा लहसुन भी छोड़ देना चाहिए और 4 नियम पालन करना चाहिए. आज मैंने जो भी बोला, यू हैव टू फॉलो दिस 4 रिलेटेड प्रिंसिपल्स. एंड वंस कंटीमाला इज वॉन, वी शुड नॉट लाइक सम पीपल गोइंग टू पंडरपुर, दे रिमूव द कंटीमाला एंड ईट प्याज लहसुन एंड देन लेटर ऑन दे वेयर इट. अच्छा नहीं है वो. इसलिए सब स्टैंडर्ड आने के बाद हम पहन सकते हैं, भगवान को श्री चरणों में अर्पित करके पहन सकते हैं. और इससे भी ज़्यादा इम्पॉर्टेंट है आपको 16 माला करना. अगर आप अभी तक 16 माला तक नहीं आए हैं तो आप पहले 16 माला तक आ जाइए, क्योंकि 16 माला आ जाइए पहले, उसके बाद कंटीमाला पहन सकते हैं. ये सब स्टैंडर्ड फॉलो करके. एंड विकास प्रभु इज आस्किंग, बट वी ऑल नो दैट मनी कैन नेवर गिव अस हैप्पीनेस. But even after knowing this many times, people still want more and more money. Why this is so? Because they think that, you know, accumulate more and then I can have a lot of money in the bank and I can relax. That never happens actually. The more you accumulate, the more you become greedy. People who have 90 rupees, they want 100. People who have 900, they want 1000. People who have lakhpatis want to become karodupatis. And those who are already karodupatis, harapatis, karapatis, they want to become lakshmipati, like Hiranyakashipu, Ravana, like that. So, but if I can assure you, if you are reading Bhagavatam regularly, you know, this greed will go away and you can, just definitely all grihasthas have to earn money and save money also. You won't say that money is not needed, money is required. But money is not the only goal of life. Side by side, we should make money, but we should make Krishna the goal of life. Dinesh Prabhu is asking, my question is, how to control anger? Prabhu, anger management we have put somewhere. Behavioral science paper, okay. Dinesh Prabhu, if you go to behavioral science for youth in live.radesham.com, you go there and then click the behavioral science for youth. There is anger management, I think two sessions, I think 1 and 2, along with that PPT and all are available. You can see that. Vaibhav Prabhu, how to come to Vishuddha Sattva stage and remain in that state forever? Wonderful question. And these are the things you have to do. First you try to come to Sattva Guna. And then earlier also we have talked about sattvic behavior, and then chant Hare Krishna 16 rounds, follow the 4 related principles, study Prabhupada's books regularly, stay in the association of devotees, keep away from non-devotees. I am also teaching this nectar of instruction on Sunday, every Sunday evening. The first 4 verses are very, very important. If you follow those 4 verses, Vachavegam, Manasvegam, Krodhavegam, we have to avoid those vegams. Then Atyahara Prayasa Prajalpa, that we have to give up. Uchahanashya Deryat, we have to adapt. And then 6 type of activities to build relation with devotees. So you can hear those first 4 words of NOI, Nectar of Instruction. Then you apply those things, then we will definitely go to Sattva and beyond Sattva to Vishuddha Sattva. Daily you study Bhagavatam also, a little bit, half an hour at least. Tushar Prabhu is asking, Chaturveda Bhajante Maham Janasukritan Arjuna. My question is that from the above shloka, which types of devotees among the 4 given shloka are most favorite to Krishna? The 4th one, Jnani. Because who is this Jnani? Because this Jnani is a person who wants knowledge of Krishna to increase his bhakti to Krishna. That is the type of Jnani mentioned here. So the 3rd type of person is Jignyasu. He doesn't know about the soul. He is trying to know knowledge of the soul, Jignyasu. Whereas the Jnani already knows about the soul. Now he wants to know super soul, about Krishna more. So that he can develop, fall in love with Krishna. So Krishna says, Tesham Jnani Nityayukta Eka Bhaktir Visheshyate. He says, the fourth one is very dear to me, he says. Yeah. Next one, Swamendu Sahabrabhu, in modern age, when distraction is so much, don't you think that men should be married as soon as they are starting to earn? And isn't it advisable to not delay? Oh, actually, Prabhupada's sister, Bhavatarini, she was 12 years old. Huh? And the mother of Prabhupada started crying. She told her husband, see, if she goes to 1 year more, 13, I will enter into Ganga and leave my body, she said. Because it's not good to keep a girl at home who is 12 years now and not married. Like that, she said at that time. Huh? In those days, a girl would be generally 10 or 11 or 12, and the boy would be generally about 14 or 15 or 16, that's the age they will marry. But after marriage, they will live with their own parents only. Boy will live with his parents, girl will live with her parents. But one good thing happens. What is it? The girl knows, I have a husband now. And she always meditates on the form of the husband. She remembers him. He's a good person. And he will come to home once in 6 months or so. They both are brought where she can cook for the husband also, do some seva also for the husband. Occasionally only they get to see each other. Otherwise, she is studying and he is studying and all that. And he also knows, now I have a wife now, so I have to be responsible now. So he will properly study, complete his academics, go to college, take up a job, responsibly earn money and start saving. When the boy becomes 18 or 19, and the girl is 16, 17, when she attains puberty, they are allowed to stay together as husband and wife. Within the next 3-4 years, they beget children, 3-4 children. That's all. By the time she is 21, 22, she has 3-4 children. Huh? You know, and the man is 24, something like that. He has 4 children, can you imagine? Now try to calculate, when the husband becomes 50, how many years? 20, the boys will be more than 25 years. Correct, no? The children will be more than 20. That means they have already grown up, their education is over, they will all be settled in life. So husband and wife are free to practice spiritual life at 50, you see. So this was ideal. But nowadays, unfortunately, there are boys who are marrying at 30, 32. Yeah? Girls are also marrying at 27, 28. Before that, they have got into a lot of character problems with so many other people. Yeah? They make friendship with somebody, get too close, and then they break the love and they go to another person. Very horrible. So as you rightly said, if somebody is starting to earn money, one can tell the parents that I want to get settled. You can settle. If you have a desire to marry, properly marry, and husband and wife practice Krishna consciousness peacefully without getting into all complications. Yeah. Manan Patil was asking, Srimad Bhagavatam padne se vairagya utpanna hota hai, lekin saath saath responsibilities bhi hoti hai. To vairagya ki wajah se phir bhautik karyon mein man nahi lagta. इसे कैसे हैंडल करना चाहिए? अच्छा प्रश्न पूछा आपने. इसके संबंध में आई हैव स्पोकन इन द सेम, गो टू live.radheshyamdas.com इन बिहेवियरल साइंस फॉर यूथ. आई हैव स्पोकन अबाउट रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी टुवर्ड्स प्रोफेशन एंड रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी टुवर्ड्स फैमिली. ये दो टॉपिक वीडियो के साथ मैंने बोला है, आप ज़रूर देखना, उधर आपको जवाब मिल जाएगा इसका. आप गृहस्थ हैं तो आपका 3 जिम्मेदारियाँ हैं, एक है भगवान की ओर, एक है बीबी बच्चे माता पिता की ओर, तीसरा है आपके काम धंधा. ये तीनों के ऊपर ट्राईपॉड जैसा, व्हाट इज अ ट्राईपॉड? ट्राईपॉड इट्स लाइक अ स्टूल. ये तीनों के ऊपर आपको ध्यान देना पड़ेगा. अगर एक नहीं दिया ध्यान दिया वो गिर जाएगा नीचे, तो डिस्टर्ब हो जाएगा फैमिली. तो आप उनको भी आप डिस्टर्ब मत कीजिए, आप भी डिस्टर्ब मत हो जाइए. तो तीनों का बैलेंस कीजिए. आप वो दो लेक्चर को सुनिए, रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी टुवर्ड्स प्रोफेशन, responsibility towards family. Kidhar hai? live.radheshyamdas.com in that behavioral science for youth. Usme aapko mil jayega video aur powerpoint mil jayega. Theek hai na? So I have answered all of your questions. So I will attach all the notes. You all leisurely go through it. Thank you. Shri Prabhupada ki.